Good evening. Welcome to Chicago Founder Stories here at 1871, Chicago's new digital startup hub. We are finishing our first year here. We have one more month left before we finish our first year, and we have an exciting group tonight. As always, pizza beer in the back on us. We will have, for those who can't make it tonight, we will have this on video, and you can see any of the past videos of Chicago Founder Stories on coolerbythelake.com. But we have a great pair today, a pair I've known for a little bit and excited. We have the founders of Starter League, Mike, Neal, welcome. It's so glad to have you guys. Thanks for being here.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.
So this is an interesting one. We often, our stories have gone further in how far they are. Last month we did Siri, and it was interesting to hear a story that, of course, we all now know, but a company he sold a couple years ago and is moving on to his next thing. You guys are right in the throes of building this thing, doing a lot of exciting things. So for our crowd here, tell us a little bit, how would you describe what Starter League does?
Take it?
Oh, you got it.
All right. The Starter League originally, it came out of this problem that we wanted to solve for ourselves. Mike and I, and we'll get into this later, we took a year to teach ourselves how to code and design some web applications, and we had a lot of challenges on the way there. So ultimately, we realized that there should have been a place that he and I could have gone to learn these skills, and when we looked, we couldn't find it. So we decided to build it. And what it is it's a school that teaches people how to code and design web apps. But it does it instead of in 1 year plus, in 3 months, it gets people to the point where they have the confidence that they could ship something. So we teach user experience design, visual design, web development with Ruby on Rails, HTML, CSS, but ultimately at the end of the day, how to ship.
That's great. Now, you're not the first people to want to code and not mm-hmm. find a way to do it. So talk about how you got the idea of actually turning it into a business, how you got the idea of setting it up the way, because there are different people who've attacked this problem in other parts of the world a little differently. How did you guys, tell us about the story of how you founded it and how you came up with the concept the way it started.
Sure. So that year was pivotal for us. That was, 2010 to 2011? May of 2010 to April of 2011, we basically just day in, day out, read every book, every tutorial, every online resource, every offline resource, every hardcover book, every hackathon, every meetup, everything you could imagine to pick up these skills. And we were relentless about it. We knew how to work, we hustled, and we worked part-time just to make ends meet. We ate ramen noodles, bread, and cheese just to get by because we wanted to learn how to code and we weren't making a lot of money and we had these ideas for for software that we wanted to build. And basically, it got to this point where everything came to a head on a number of factors. But really what we realized is that, when we looked at the graduate computer science programs, we looked at all the different ways that we could go about getting a more formal education in order to do this. They either didn't really fit our budget because we didn't have a lot of money, or they weren't teaching the things that we were teaching ourselves or wanted to learn, which were very tangible, practical technologies that companies and startups are using.
So let's walk us through it real tangibly. So you guys are reading, studying, you're doing all mm-hmm. this. Mm-hmm. At some point, you're saying to yourselves, this should exist, right? The classic entrepreneur moment where you're like, why isn't somebody already doing this? Because I'd do it. I'd participate. I'd buy. But at what point did that turn into looking and longing and working hard, hustling to do it, into starting to say, hey, we should work on this idea?
Quickly, we spent, a good 6 to 8 months, building our own ideas. Uh-huh. And then it got to a point where in the spring of 2011, we just heard from, different sources, of the problems. We had a breakfast at Golden Olympic, and one of the, from the Northwestern perspective, it was, we have all these really talented college graduates, coming
these
out.
These are both... talented Northwestern alums. You can see their purple right there.
We were with Brad Moorhead.
Brad Moorhead.
And, so he's a Northwestern alum as well.
Yeah, and he mentioned the fact that, we have all these really talented college graduates coming out, but they're not staying in Chicago. They're going to the coast, and we want to keep them here. Then we had our own personal experience of wanting to learn how to code and design and build web applications, but we weren't at the level yet. And then there were people in Chicago coming up with all these amazing ideas, but no one had the talent to build them. And so we kept hearing all these things, and so we decided to, instead of building our own web applications, let's build a school for other people to build their web applications. So that's kind of how
we get
turned.
To build ours, too.
Yeah, and then we get to build ours.
So the idea of building it as a model where you create a school. Like, that's no small undertaking.
Mm-hmm.
So I just built an app and put it out there and seeing who finds you. So how'd you figure this out? How'd you decide, you know, this is the model we want to build? What made it the right model for you?
There was no example of what we wanted. Yeah. I looked. I did all the due diligence. That's what I did before, you know, working in venture and stuff like that. But, we kept it real simple. We had a whiteboard. It was actually a shower wall. It was a piece of shower wall from Home Depot. Like, you can get it for like $11. And so we just taped that on the wall. And basically, we just listed out the things that you need in order to have a school, or at least in our head, our idea of what a school could be. It was really simple. So you need a teacher, you need a classroom, you need a curriculum, you need students, you'll probably need a website, you'll need computers. Money. So those things. And we just listed them out and we said, all right, which one can we start with? So we kind of started with two. We started with the website and we tried to get an instructor. So those are the two things we started with. And you know, obviously this whole time, Mike and I are meeting with people and like just selling the idea to the Chicago community and getting a feel for, you know, whether there was real demand for this and whether if we put a site up and we said we could do this, whether people would actually sign up and do it. And, you know, we got real lucky to find out that that was the case, but it didn't come after, it was like 4 or 5 months of really hard work to get the school off the ground before we could even make it happen.
And in terms of how we started, I mean, we can, you know, kind of tell them about, you know, talking to our friends. Like,
yeah.
We kind of
decided
like how much would, you know, you pay for a program like this. So basically we just, you know, we all gathered a group of like 5 to 6 friends and we just emailed them. Like, hey, would you want to do this? How much would you pay? You know, and the range was, you know, between $5,000 to $10,000.
Yeah.
And so that's when we kind of decided, just kind of picked the number to start with.
Well, it's a little more than that too, because that, honestly, those people we asked,
they
none of them signed up for the class. So that was total bull. Really, what the other part that influenced our, you know, what we set it at was based on what we needed. Mm-hmm. So we knew who we were gonna, like, who was gonna teach. We didn't know where we were gonna teach it, but we had a reasonable guess for the square footage and what rent would be and that kind of stuff. And we knew how much hardware could cost, and we knew how much we needed to stay, you know, afloat. And I just modeled that out. It was a simple one-page Excel spreadsheet with, you know, expenses and revenue, and we were just like, how much do we need to charge in order to make sure this isn't, you know, negative? And that was how we set the price. That's it.
And so you get ready to launch, you got your bottle. I was one of the people, I was one of your many networking mm-hmm. stops. I only met Mike recently, but Neil's one of the great networkers because I saw him when he was in stool, when he was out of school.
Yeah, we met at the Chicago Club. And
Great. And, you know, always have excited and passionate, and, you know, people love that. And, of course, Northwestern people love to help other Northwestern people.
Definitely.
But, and I remember saying, I need JavaScript people. And you were like, we're not there yet, but I'll sign up as soon as you have it. But you guys are out there. You get this demand. So talk about the idea of getting it off the ground. Because, so you have this idea. You've got mm-hmm. the model. You've got the plan. So what happens?
Yeah, so it was the summer. The summer was such a pivotal time. So we were doing a lot of weird things. You know, we were originally a nonprofit. There's an interesting kind of tale as to how we evolved into an LLC. There's also the fact that we were working really hard to try to get some initial funding, believe it or not, because I had, like, the investment background, having worked at a few firms in Chicago, and I thought that, you know, we needed some resources because we didn't know whether people were actually going to sign up for the class. And then there was the website we had to build and launch, and there was a lot of work to find an instructor and bring on mentors and just build this community around this concept, as well as find a space. And, you know, when we launched the site, I remember when we launched the site, we had no idea what to expect. We didn't know what was going to happen. We just put a site out there. We had told a lot of people about it. We emailed people about it. We tweeted, Facebook, what have you. And, you know, 2 weeks later, we had, I don't know, over 50 applications or so.
Yeah. Even before, like, so there was, in that summer, from, like, we came up with the idea, actually, like, around March 22nd to March 28th is when the week that we formed this idea. But even before August, when we kind of officially launched, there were a lot of stops kind of in the way there. One kind of key was when we launched our landing page in June of 2011, we actually didn't have an instructor. So when it was still, you know, Accelerate Labs, now TechStar Chicago, we launched the site, and we went to their, like, launch day for the summer program in 2011, and some of our advisors had tweeted out our landing page. We were kind of like scared about that. We're like, oh, wait, we weren't ready to like launch yet. But luckily, after a couple retweets, we got a tweet from a guy named Jeff Cohen, who's also a Northwestern grad. And he like sent us a DM and he sent us an email. And he's like, hey, my name is Jeff Cohen. I've been a programmer for 15, 20 years. I've been teaching on the side with my own company for 5 to 7 years. I would love to help out in any way, potentially teach. And we had spent like a good month, like trying to look
just
for
fell it fell into our laps.
Like, who's going to quit their, like, who has enough skill to teach beginners in 3 months how to code? But then after that, who's going to quit their job? And then after that, who's going to take a pay cut? We had no clue
what
we were going to do. And then our instructor found us. And so after that, you know, Neal had a couple meetings.
We had a couple meetings, but the interesting thing there that people don't know is that we didn't convince Jeff to quit his job.
Yeah.
He was just going to, like, part-time it a little bit. Because the model was, let's convince 12 people to sign up for a class. We wanted 12 people to sign up for a class. And we were like, we'll do one class, and we'll do it in, like, the afternoons on a couple days a week. Turns out we got way more demand than we could have ever imagined, and we ended up doing two classes. And then I convinced Jeff to quit his job.
When you first signed up?
So we started with 35 students. Yeah. We had 88 applications, I think. And we interviewed 45 people. And after those, we interviewed 45 people in 4 days.
Wow.
It was ridiculous.
We
took one day off for Accelerate Demo Day in the middle. But Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday of a week, we interviewed 45 people. And that was the most epic week of my life. It was crazy to look at these people across the table. Yeah. People like Vincent here in the front row. Now, you know, he works for us now, but it was just amazing to look across and see these stories, these people that were quitting their jobs, that wanted to change, that shared our stories, that had went through even tougher times than we did, and they got it, and they were ready to take the plunge and do something amazing. So, I don't know, I consider those people our first investors. Those are the people that really took a bet on us, just as much, if not more, than we took on them to make this happen, and they're the ones that we have to thank for, you know, what we have now.
We'll come back to that, because I think they were your actual first people to give you money.
They were. Actually, no, they weren't, because Google Checkout held that money for 2 weeks, and I didn't know that they were going to do that, so that sucked. So that's why we switched from a nonprofit to a for-profit. So we were a nonprofit, and we needed this money to put a down payment on a sublease for 10 cubicles at Groupon, and then we didn't have the money to do that or to get the hardware we needed for the machines that we had promised our students we would have.
Yeah.
We won $10,000 in cash at Spark Chicago. It was a startup competition during Tech Week for working on a web app idea that Mike and I wanted to build online. We won 10 grand for that idea, but it was considered a business, its own private company. So, I mean, I learned a lot of this talking to lawyers, but basically sharing money with a for-profit and a non-profit is bad on a legal and an accounting, like, domain. So basically what we decided to do was merge the entities, take the 10 grand we needed, put the down payment down, and make that, that happen. So that's why we switched. It was a pretty, like, I don't know, last-minute Hail Mary kind of decision to make sure we had the resources to deliver. So
yeah, because we tried to juggle having two companies and who would be the leaders in both and who would, you know, do design and development in the other, but, you know, Neal, the month of August 2011 was like lawyer month, where we're B Corp or we're L3C or this, and we eventually decided on the LLC. But in terms of like the Google Checkout story, you know, after we interviewed all those people and we accepted, we ended up getting 35 people. We're like, all right, so we need to give you, or you need to give us, you know, money up front so we can pay for all the things that we promised on our website. Because
exactly
nothing existed. Like if you go on like
we didn't have any pictures. Yeah. We didn't have any. We had illustrations of furniture.
Yeah, we had a computer illustration. We had like, we're going to have comfy chairs, and we're going to have a couch.
It's going to be
great. We never bought a couch.
A couch. Yeah,
so that's one promise that we have broken. But we had no pictures of the space because we had no space, so we had to not only convince them that they could learn, but they had to trust us to give us their money, and then we couldn't use the money for 2 weeks, so we had like a week to buy, you know, get a space, pay for it, get
computers. Buy all the stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, the computers arrived. I closed the lease 3 days before class started. The computers arrived 2 days before class started. And I didn't have the money to pay for all those computers. So I convinced Fred Lee, who's awesome, with Innova, to sponsor those computers because I needed it. Because we had the money from the students, but it wasn't in our bank accounts because Google held it.
Yeah, Fred Lee was our dad for a while.
Yeah, he was
dad.
Like dad.
Thanks
for that.
Thanks for it.
I want to come back to, you know, a little more of the founding story experience at Accelerate, but But go back, because you both obviously met at Northwestern, and there's some interesting entrepreneurial stories there. But just give a little context. Talk about, you know, where'd you grow up? You know, how'd you, the path to being an entrepreneur, talk about where it started.
Yeah, so I grew up in a small town 2 hours west of here called Freeport. Kind of the major fun fact from Freeport is that my high school mascot was a pretzel. So we were the Freeport Pretzels. Don't laugh. That's amazing. What was your high school, like Knights or Lions? We had pretzels. It's so unique. But we are officially Pretzel City USA, and our motto was, if you can't eat us, but you can't beat us, which doesn't make sense. Because if you eat us, you've kind of killed us. But anyway, it rhymed. It was awesome. So that was my Freeport experience. So I wanted to get to a big city. And so I found Northwestern. So I was kind of interested in, you know, design and, you know, film, but also interested in kind of history and politics. So I came to Northwestern as a political science and then film major. And then my sophomore year, I met Neal in student government. So Neal was running for student body president, and I was just on one of the committees, and he convinced me to run for a campus-wide position. Which I thought was crazy at the time. I was like, I'm not going to do that. You know, I don't want to lose because then 8,000 people know that I'm a loser. And that's not cool. But eventually I did it and was lucky enough to win, and he won student body president. So that was kind of the start of our...
What was your job as a sophomore?
It was academic vice president, which is really funny because I kind of stopped caring about classes after sophomore year. So I don't know if I was the best academic vice president. But it was a fun job, working on behalf of the student body. That's where I got to know Neal, and we just basically spent the next 2 years together working with Little Sleep. So that's the quick story.
That's great. And you're a Chicagoan, Neal?
Yeah, I'm from the South Side, so I grew up on the outskirts of Hyde Park in the Kenwood neighborhood, technically. So I went to CPS school, then I went to Catholic school at Mount Carmel. I was a football guy. I thought I was going to like go to the NFL or something, but I also ran in the Junior Olympics for like 8 years. So I was really passionate about track and field as well.
What did you run? What was
your So 1-2-4, 4x4, 4x1, 4x2.
I was an 800 guy. So
long jump.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. He ran track too. I was lucky enough, so lucky, to go to Mount Carmel, not only play football and run track, but, you know, I did well enough to get into Northwestern, which was like a long shot in my head, but I got in, and it was great. And I thought I was going to be an athlete. So I was going to walk onto the football team, and I was going to run on the track team. Well, I didn't do my homework because Northwestern is the only Big Ten school that does not have a track and field team. Yeah. I did not know that.
That's why I tried to walk on at UW-Madison so bad. Instead of Northwestern.
Anyway, that sucked. So anyway, I decided that because I couldn't run track and field.
That's how your due diligence got better.
Yeah. My due diligence got a lot better. And I decided that I was going to focus just on my studies and try to be a good student and figure out what I wanted to do with my life. So the short story of like this wacky Northwestern experience, at least underclass, is I got to Northwestern, did some reflection on like, you know, why I'm here and what's the meaning of life and who am I and, you know, all that stuff. And at first I came in because, you know, I didn't grow up with a lot. We didn't have a lot of money and it was always a problem. There were always issues of things we didn't have and I thought I needed to make a lot of money. So when I got to Northwestern, what people do that want to make a lot of money is they study econ, they become an investment banker or consultant. So I studied econ and I tried to become an investment banker or consultant. And in doing that, I got lucky because I met some people that like showed me other things that I could be doing. So while I really pursued finance and I studied econ and I read the vault guides and I prepared for the interviews, I even got some job offers. I got an offer from UBS to work in M&A as an investment banker. The other side of the story is I met Rishi Shah and Derek Moeller freshman year, and we were working on the Nugget Group, which is a finance club in Northwestern, and they had an idea to start a business to put LCD screens, eventually, in doctor's offices to educate patients while they wait.
For those of you who weren't here, that's Context Media, who was here a couple months ago, and a great story. They mentioned that you worked with them at Northwestern, and I'd love to hear the story of how it really started, because we kind of glossed over the early part.
Right.
We picked up the story where they had this idea, talking to Rishi's dad.
Yes, yeah.
But I understand there might be something that happened before they got the idea from Rishi's dad. It was a doctor about this need in doctor's office.
Yes, there was. And most people don't know this. But it was so much fun to get to know those guys. I was like, 17, 18 years old, freshman in college, second quarter. It was like January, February in 2006. And the original idea, what they tasked me to do, because I was basically learning and working, you know, with and for them, was to make a spreadsheet, a list. This is back when Google Spreadsheets first came out, a list of all the liquor stores in the Chicago area. Because the original idea was to put, like, beautiful images of cold, frosty beer when you walk into a liquor store on this digital screen. So the idea was actually to put LCD screens in liquor stores. But we pivoted because Rishi's dad was an endocrinologist. So his idea was basically like, look, that's not really our passion project. I think we can help way more people if we do this and we educate patients in the waiting room. So I learned so much working for those guys. It was like an incredible experience because by day, I was, you know, trying to be a good student. I didn't do a good job. I didn't do a good job at all. But by night and by weekend and by a lot of my days, I was traveling downtown because they had raised angel money. They had investment, and we were downtown. It was the three of us, and I was hiring people and firing people almost twice my age on the sales team. And it was incredible to learn so much from them. So my whole idea as to what I could be doing with my life kind of got unlocked. So the next year, I ended up leaving Context Media because Rishi dropped out of college, and Derek at the time, he had already graduated. I really didn't, like, I wasn't sure what I wanted to do, but I was a sophomore in college, and I was like, I'm not going to drop out. I should probably stay in school and take what I learned and do something else. So sophomore year, I did something else crazy. I got tired of how expensive it was for black people to get haircuts on the south side of Chicago. And I decided I was going to start a barbershop. So I tried to do that, wrote a business plan, met like 25 barbershops. The barbershop number 26 said, hey, why don't you come in and take over and help me run this shop and let's open up another one. So we did that. So I started a barbershop.
How'd that go?
It was cool. I learned a lot. I learned that it's not easy. And I also learned that while it was a cool project and it was a good lesson in entrepreneurship, it wasn't really what I felt like the meaning of my life should be. So after like 5 months of running that shop, I decided that, okay, I'm going to be a junior in college. I should probably focus on that. So I kept like moving around. And then junior year, that's when I was very involved in this student organization called ISBE, which was the product of, you know, Derek, Rishi, and I like kind of helped build that with some other people. And that was the largest business group in Northwestern. So I was the president of that. And then basically what happened is we had a representative for student government, a senator. And the senator went on medical leave for the quarter. So we didn't have anyone to fill in. So I filled in for a quarter. And in filling in during that quarter, I met Mike in student government. And then I saw all of the things that could have been better about Northwestern itself and the student body. So I decided to run for student body president after that. And that's where I met Mike, and that's where we solved a lot of really hard problems together for Northwestern. And then simultaneously getting elected, I was lucky enough to meet Jim Dugan at OCA Ventures, and that's how I got the job working in venture capital, and that's right around the moment where I turned down the opportunity to work for UBS. So that was a pivotal moment for me because I ended up working in venture capital, simultaneously being student body president, getting to know this guy, and trying to be a full-time student on top of everything. So
yeah, it was fun to watch that.
Yeah. Yeah.
I can see why class was hard to make.
Yeah, it was really hard. Like, it got to the point where I remember my class schedule was Tuesdays and Thursdays, all my classes were loaded up. They're like three-hour classes. It was Tuesday 9 to 9, Thursday 9 to 9, straight through all my classes, Monday, Wednesday, Friday. I worked from 6 a.m. till 5 p.m. at OCA Ventures downtown. So I would come straight to the student government office at night, work with Mike, and then on the weekends work all the way through. So yeah, we learned how to work together then. So I think that's a key part that we
you
don't
guys
share
might
that
be
much.
Common law married, I tell you.
Yeah. No, I mean, he's the only one I saw, like when we would leave the office for student government, there would be one light on in the other office and it was always his. He was the only one that could, you know, outwork me from time to time.
I was trying to get gray hair by the age of 20. I almost made it, but
so what did you do after college?
I guess the best way to start this was 2 months before I graduated. Neal graduated Northwestern in 2009, and about, I guess, beginning of April of 2010, I still hadn't found a job. A lot of my friends were getting those consulting jobs and banking jobs, and I was just bored by all that. I was having really a lot of fun being student body president. After Neal was student body president, I was able to...
Do you want to do it like a time freeze? Because I think there's an interesting year leading up to that moment where Mike got that phone call from me. that I can talk about, because I was out of college a year before him.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, so basically what happened is I graduated, Mike became student body president, which was awesome. But then I had to, like, enter the real world and do real work.
Yeah.
So when I graduated, everyone was like, oh, Neal, great, you did venture capital, you're student body president, you started a couple companies, you've done all these awesome things, what are you going to do now? And I was like, I don't know. I didn't know, and I was totally comfortable with that. I knew that I would be okay, and I knew that I learned enough at that point that I wasn't just going to jump into something for the sake of it, that I wanted to focus and figure out what I was passionate about. And in the meantime, I ended up running out of money, so I needed to do something. So I convinced Northwestern to hire me as the first ever alumni Safe Ride driver. And what Safe Ride is, for those of you that don't know, is it's basically a taxi service for Northwestern. So I was the first ever alum that drove Safe, because it was for students to make money on the side when they were at Northwestern. So I made like $11 an hour driving Safe Ride cars by night from like 7 p.m. to 3 a.m. for like 4 or 5 months. And that's how I made ends meet while I was just in my, you know, spiritual journey to figure out the meaning of life for me. But then I got lucky enough to get hired by Sandbox Industries. So I met Harper Reed and Troy Hennikoff, who was my professor at Northwestern. And they connected me to Sandbox. And Sandbox, out of nowhere, right before I was going to move to Seattle to create a new life doing video game development with like Nintendo or Valve in Seattle, I got hired by Sandbox to be basically an entrepreneur in residence. So my job there was come up with awesome ideas because, you know, you seem like a scrappy entrepreneur. Take, you know, our money, hire a team, build a team of developers and designers, and execute on those ideas. That was my job at Sandbox. Sounds like the best job ever. And it kind of was. But the only problem was that I was hiring developers and designers to make my ideas real. And I lacked the capacity. I felt like I was like an armless architect, you know? Like I didn't have the skills to actually make something real myself. And it was terrible. It was so draining because I had no idea what these people were talking about. And we were burning thousands and thousands of dollars a week on, you know, working with people. But they didn't have the passion that I had for the idea. So I went through this for like 5 months, and during that time, Mike was getting ready to graduate, so I guess I will pass the mic.
So it was funny about the before Sandbox, like Neal, what he hasn't mentioned at least tonight is like he's really passionate about video games. Like this guy's
a
gamer, and kind of the one of the, you know, passions of, you know, that he had was to, you know, go to Seattle to, you know, get into the game, you know, gaming industry. And so when I was, you know, in my senior year, at least for like the fall of, you know, I guess 2009, the idea was like, okay, Neal's going to Seattle. You had never been to Seattle, right?
No, I'd never been. My brother lives there. I never met him.
Yeah. So he was going to go to Seattle.
I was going to live with him.
to get into the gaming industry. And literally like a week before,
I left.
Like, he's all like pretty much packed, ready to go. Like he, you know, had like this marathon of meetings at Sandbox and then got a job offer. And so he like called me up and was like, oh, I'm staying in Chicago. So that's when he got the job at Sandbox. And then fast forward about 5 months, April 2010, and Neal gives me a call. And it's like, hey, Mike, I quit my job. I want to learn how to code, and I want you to learn with me. And I was like, okay, sure. I wasn't doing anything better at the time. And it was like all of my prospects were things I didn't want to do. And I kind of got spoiled by working in student government, just kind of doing what I wanted to do for the past 2 years. So the prospect
is
just, yeah, for free. Yeah, that's okay. Northwestern, they'll pay us back. We got our bills. It was just, I just wanted to do something that was, you know, solving a problem for other people. And then when Neal gave me that call, it was like an opportunity, not only to work with Neal, but also to have an opportunity to solve problems for a larger audience. You know, it was 8,000 undergraduates at Northwestern, but it was the whole universe, you know, in terms of working on a startup and building ideas. So that's when I was like, sure, I'll join Neal. And actually, a week later, I got a job offer to work, with Urban Prep. So like, it came a week too late. So I was like, no, I'm already committed to do this. And I told my mom, I'm like, hey, so I'm just gonna do this startup thing and learn how to code. And I don't have a job right now. And then she was like, what? But she's like, well, as long as you have food and a place to stay, I'm like, yes,
I will make that. Stay.
I'll make that work. So the place to stay. You want me to tell that?
Because basically the thing that happened was when I quit my job, it was like a knee jerk decision. There was no planning involved. It was like I read Rework by 37 Singles. I read that book. Yeah. It just came out, and it's funny because in the book it says, "Don't quit your job."
Yeah.
sorry, like I already had to reject some of what I learned, but I quit my job immediately because I knew that I had to do something different. I needed to teach myself how to do this. And, you know, Mike had some graphic design skill, no coding, but I figured he could focus on front-end coding and I could focus on back-end. And that's what we did. We kind of, you know, focused on that. But when I quit my job, just out of nowhere, I told my dad, I was living with my dad, you know, it's like kind of cheap rent. It wasn't free rent, he made me pay, but it was cheap rent. And I said, hey, Dad, quit my job today. And, you know, he gave me that, what the hell's wrong with you look. And then I said, also, I need you to move out because I'm going to move Mike in and we're going to start a company out of this condo. And he thought I was crazy. So 3 days later of negotiating with my dad, I convinced him that we would pay him full market rate rent so he could have a nicer apartment so that Mike and I could convert the condo that I grew up in my whole life into a startup office for him and I to learn how to code.
So I moved into his dad's room. So.
Basically, he did. Yeah. He did. So that's basically what happened. Yeah. We convinced my dad to move out. We got some furniture from IKEA. We gutted the place, and we just turned it into our hub of learning and executing and building. And it was just this crazy time for us because we didn't know what was going to happen. We were broke. We were cooking every day. We got up at 7 a.m. routinely, met at 7:30, worked till about 11 p.m., day and night for, I guess, a year. So that's what we did.
Now, you guys were in Accelerate.
No. So we were involved. So Troy, like Troy Hinnikoff, like, I guess, CEO of Accelerate now, Techstars Chicago.
We were going to apply to
Accelerate with one of our ideas because it was when I was around when Accelerate first was like an idea and it got developed very similar to how 1871 came to fruition. It was like a community of awesome Chicagoans that came together and said, we need to do this. We need to invest in our community. We need to build better startups and help them out with all the mentorship and community. So it's a fun pattern to have been a part of for, you know, the past eight years or so, it seems like 8 or 9 years. And I guess to keep things short, I was very involved in like helping Troy out with Accelerate wherever he needed. I was the photographer for some of the events they had. That was like how I made a little money on the side. We were trying to get things going. We were just very involved. So we were there at the initial meetings and all that kind of stuff.
That's great. Now, I want to work in a question here because this is the first time I've had a question get 10 votes.
Mm-hmm. That's good.
So, Neal, how much do you curl, and is it hard to find Starter League hoodies that your arms don't bust through?
Oh, wow.
I'm thinking that maybe Starter League people doing that to you.
Do you even lift? Okay. I said I was an athlete before. I just kind of – I have a frame, and it's hard. Like, I'm sorry. I have big arms. That's just how it is.
I'm thinking those are friends of yours going for you.
I hope so.
I have big arms. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about – you started as Code Academy.
Right, that was our name.
And then you turned into the Starter League.
We evolved.
Evolved into the Starter League.
Yes.
So you've got this initial, when you did the built in Chicago, were you Starter League yet?
Yeah.
You were
the Moxie Awards? Or?
Yeah, we were still Code Academy.
We were Code Academy.
All right, so you're Code Academy. So I wasn't there, but my friend Matt Moog told me the story of of what your
I remember
comments.
That.
This is a great story. So these guys win a Moxie Award.
We won three.
Three Moxie Awards.
Just saying.
I'm sorry.
Just saying.
They won three Moxie Awards. I wasn't there, but I heard you guys were great. So they win three Moxie Awards for getting the company off the ground, really starting well. And I heard your remarks were great because you thanked the venture capitalists in town.
Well, yeah. Well, first, Neal, obviously you can tell tonight, when Neal's active and engaged, he can, tell a great story. But sometimes Neal is just like, you know what, I'm not going to say anything. So if we win, you have to say all the things.
I had a few drinks.
Yes, I was going to mention. It also didn't, help that he had a lot of drinks, including some of mine, which helped me out. So I would just get drinks, and he's like, oh, thanks, Mike.
So he had to
cover the speaking duties. I think it was one of the, maybe the second award, but I said my line was like, the first line was like, thank you for not giving us money. And so I guess the kind of the
you guys hadn't raised any money at this
well,
point.
Well, yeah, so no. I mean, I guess we can jump into this story as so we kind of glossed over that. But I mean, the whole idea is that we thought we needed money to start the school because we had none. So we're like, okay, how are we going to convince an instructor? How are we going to get space? So we did the quick calculations, like $250,000.
That's what we thought we needed.
So with Neal's, connections and, the venture capital investment community, we, spread our idea, and we thought that we were going to be able to get the money to, you know, do everything we needed. The other kind of fun part of the journey was Harper Reed, who helped Neil kind of get the Sandbox connection.
We glossed over that.
Oh, we've glossed over a lot.
You guys have a lot for just young guys.
It's been a fun passing years.
That's great.
After we decided to go in with this Code Academy idea, we were going around Chicago, spreading the idea, getting everyone really excited. And about 3 weeks into that,
there were two things that happened with Harper. So Harper Reed, if you all don't know him, he was the CTO of Threadless. Then he was just kind of this hobo technologist for 2 years. And then he just calls me up and goes, hey, I'm the CTO for Barack Obama's reelection campaign. So, I mean, it was cool to be friends with him, but it was funny because he had just introduced me to a guy who had a software development shop in Uruguay. Yeah. And he basically connected me to this guy who, he was the original Rails developer for Twitter. And he had the software development shop in Uruguay. And I met with him in a 4-hour layover at O'Hare Airport, this guy from Uruguay. And he decided that he was going to hire me to help lead his software company in Uruguay on the business side. And in exchange, he would teach me how to code. I bought a plane ticket right there. I had $2,000 in the bank. I spent $1,000 on a ticket to Uruguay because I thought I was going to do that. Yeah. Then the next week, Harper drops the bomb that he's working for Barack Obama now and that also he has a position on the campaign for one of the product leads for the software division. Yeah. And he asked me if I want the job. So I have Uruguay, I have this Code Academy idea, and then we have, this opportunity, or I have this opportunity to work for, Harper, for Barack Obama and get him reelected. And I said no. I said no immediately. And the reason I said no is because Mike had sacrificed so much to work with me and to do this. So I turned it down. And then the next week, Harper calls back and says, we'll hire both of you. So we had a tough decision on our hands. I decided not to go to Uruguay. I canceled my plane ticket. Did not get a refund. It sucked.
Yeah.
But then we were like, all right, do we help reelect the leader of the free world, or do we try to start this school that we have no idea is going to be successful at all? After a couple weeks of debating and, Michael Slaby, Harper's boss, got into the mix and all this stuff, we ultimately decided to still try to start the school.
Yeah.
So that was a really, really difficult decision for us because we had a lot of other opportunities that we could have pursued at that point because people were impressed by what we had put ourselves through in teaching ourselves how to, build stuff.
Yeah, right around that time was when, this 1871, it was a tech center kind of project was going on because in, March of that month, we were getting the community development, but also the entrepreneur community really excited about our idea. And that's still when the Uruguay trip was still in play. I think even before, we'd even got offered, Neil got offered the Obama position, but I remember there was one distinct conversation that Neil had with Troy. And it was when all this, really building in the spring of 2011. And I think Neil asked him, paraphrasing the question, should I go? Because he was going to be gone for a whole summer. So I was going to have the apartment to myself for 3 months. So I was like, oh, yeah, Neil, just go. Go to Uruguay. We'll be fine here. It got to a head when we were like, hey, we want to build this school to teach people how to code. And it was this tech center idea to build a physical place in downtown Chicago.
There was murmuring of a tech center. It was in
so we met with them. And then I think Troy basically said, it would be really hard for you to be in Uruguay and run and be a part of this movement. So you shouldn't leave, basically.
He said I shouldn't. Yeah, he told us that I shouldn't leave because Chicago was heating up.
Yeah,
he said Chicago was getting to a point where he was like, Neil, I think you should stay.
Yeah.
I think you should be a part of this because some interesting things are on the horizon.
Yeah.
He also advised me. It was two people that really helped us decide between Obama and Code Academy, and that was it was Troy. I remember I pulled over. And I had a conversation with him on my way down from Evanston, and I talked to him, and he said, I think you could make a much bigger impact if you made that school happen, even though the Obama thing is a better possibility for you right now in terms of risk management, but in terms of, value to people and to the world, I think if you started that school, it would be great. The other person that convinced me to do it was Kevin Willer. So at Experience, when we met, and I'm going to quote you, he said, look, this is bigger than Obama. That's what he said.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay. Yeah. All right. I guess we're gonna do this.
There's even more juice in this story now. It's all coming back. But that was Future Founders.
Yeah, it was Future Founders.
Yeah, it was the.
I was the presenter for that.
Yeah, he was the MC for that. And that morning, I was a mentor for Future Founders, so I was in attendance, and we had pretty much decided because there was a lot that went on before that. we're probably going to do this Obama thing. Like, we kind of had the feeling the Obama campaign was more in like in the lead at that point. But after Neal had this meeting with Kevin and he emceed the event, then he got pulled away by Harper. Michael
Slaby. Yeah, we met with Michael Slaby, and then they pulled us back over to the Obama side. I don't want to belabor this too much, but the short of it is basically we kept going back and forth, and then Friday night at 7 p.m., I got a phone call from Steve Collins, who's helped out with behind 1871, and he said, how much do you need to make this happen? And basically, he kind of lured us in with the idea that they would actually help us get money. And that was like based on that conversation I had with Steve.
So what'd you tell him?
I'll get back to you. That was a long weekend.
Yeah.
We basically, he didn't sleep. I slept a little bit because I needed the stamina to present. But basically, that weekend, we spent the whole weekend building a deck and a proposal, a floor plan, and that whole idea as to how we could make this happen and what resources we needed. That's what we did. And in doing that, that's where we got the confidence that we could actually make this happen.
You present. Yeah. Tell us about the presentation.
So we met with New World that next week. We met with Matt McCall, who's one of the best mentors, advisors, and venture capitalists in Chicago. That man is so helpful.
Great guy.
And I sat there in the room with him and Steve, and Mike remembers. I remember you walked away heated.
No. Well, this is before. Well, so the quick thing of how we ended up deciding over the Obama campaign is, like, Neal had the first meeting with New World, and he had a great presentation, and then he was like, wait, but we have this one thing. We had this Obama.
We have to decide between
the Obama or the Code Academy ideas, like, but if we get the money that we need, we will do it. And then that's when Matt McCall said, we will get you the money.
We will get you
And so
money.
That's when going to the Moxie Awards, when through that summer, we actually didn't get the money. So we turned down Obama. Actually, my mom actually forwarded me the Obama decline letter that we sent in. So we had until 5 p.m. on this date in May to send in the decline letter. So we sent it in. And we decided, like, we're going all in, we're going to get this money, it's going to be great, we're going to build a school. And then from June of 2011 to August of 2011, we basically spent, like, trying to get the money. So we actually never got the money.
It was the due diligence.
Yeah, the
that whole due diligence game. I was on the other side of the table, finally.
Yeah. How'd it work?
It was great. it was good because they asked us a lot of tough questions, but at the end of the day, nobody believed that there was a market for this. Nobody believed that we actually could find people to pay.
So they end up great people, but they end up saying, we're not going to invest.
Not necessarily.
No.
So I convinced, it got to the point where right around like the time we were about to launch the website, it was finally coming together. You know, Jim Dugan, who was my boss at OCA Ventures, CEO, another amazing person in Chicago, just one of the best people for Chicago in the venture capital community. Jim, Matt and Steve and all these great people came together and they were going to hook us up with the resources we needed. And right before that happened, we launched our website. And when we launched our website, we learned something that we could have never imagined, which I mentioned before. The demand was incredible for this. And once we had proven the demand, and basically they said, all right, we're ready to do the deal, I said, on second thought, I think we'll be all right. So that was what Mike meant when he said, thank you, New World, for not giving us money.
Because
we ended up becoming a bootstrap company.
We backed our way into a bootstrap business. Which worked out.
Yeah.
So these guys, so in his thank you speech, usually you thank your first funder, and Mike thanked the people who didn't give him money, which I think is the first in venture capital history to have. Be thanked for not giving
making
money.
Making history.
I will check that out.
One day at a time.
But we also did, what we talked about earlier.
It's legend.
Yeah.
The only thing I heard about the next day was your talk.
Well, it was really funny because after I said that, like, the first person that greeted us was Matt McCall.
He came over and gave us a big hug.
He felt so bad. He's like, I feel so bad.
It was all love.
It was great.
Jamie thought it was funny.
Oh, yeah.
It was great. It's a great success.
Well, we also thanked the first 35 students who, paid up front. Like, that gave
that
us the confidence
that changed
say no to them because we basically had made the money that we were going to get in the loan from the, VCs. So.
Okay, so you're running Code Academy. Things are going well. Let's talk a little bit about evolving into the starter league.
Okay.
Yeah.
So how did that happen, how did you get the investment?
Well, I will say, though, that running Code Academy was going well. That's not all, like, just, kicking rocks. It's simple. It sounds simple now, but when you look back, we did all that work. But then day one, we're on the second floor of Groupon. There's 10 cubicles. 10 cubicles and 20 chairs. So we had 17 people in one class, 18 people in another. and our instructor standing with a cardboard box and his computer on top of it. That was his podium. That was our class. And the wall was green because it's Groupon. And that's not good for a projector that we had mounted on another cardboard box. So we got white sheets of paper, and we taped all the pieces of paper together, and we taped it on the wall. And that was our projector wall. So, and then we're sitting there on the first day, after these people paid us thousands of dollars, we're like, we're about to teach you guys how to code.
Yeah.
This is going to be fine.
Yeah.
So, but what ended up happening was something special. We did it. We did it. Like, they learned, they prototyped, they shipped, they built things, they got jobs, they started companies, they did all the things that we dreamed of in 3 months. And once that happened, we were off to the races. So yes, 35 students next quarter, 56 students next quarter, 88 students next quarter, 93 next quarter, 120. And it was just incredible, like that whole experience and how this culture formed and how these amazing people from all over the world decided that it was worth quitting their jobs and moving to Chicago to change their life and to learn some of the hardest skills you can learn in the software, in this world of technology and entrepreneurship. So yeah. I just didn't want to gloss over that because we did become the Starter League, they were, like that whole time is really what made us who we are.
Yeah. So I mean, the stories are like the most powerful thing. Like when Neal talked about that first week of interviews, you know, for the 6 months before then, we were just the crazy ones in our apartment saying, like, these people are out there. We don't know who they are.
We think they're out there.
It was pretty strong. We knew, they were around somewhere. We just had to hope that they would find us. And then when we interviewed them, that's when we learned all these great stories. I mean, we had, you know, one student who moved his family to another state so he could move from Colorado to Chicago.
Yep, he moved his family in with his parents, his wife and his kids in Utah. And then he came to Chicago for 3 months.
To get a job, and now he's back in Colorado.
And he's working in Colorado. Yeah, he's working
there. Yeah, we had people who came from Florida. We had a 21-year-old.
Philippines.
Over 8,000 miles from the Philippines to Chicago. So many great stories. Wow. A guy come in with a $6,000 check before we interviewed him, saying, like, I just quit my job 2 weeks ago.
On the table.
I'm ready to
Let
do this.
Let me in.
Those are just, like, four of the amazing stories from just the first class, but... that's when we knew that we had something because these people had made way more sacrifices than we had to do this. And this was a program that had never existed. It was just a promise on a website. And so that's when we knew. But even with that, we had to say, like, okay, you made all these sacrifices. Now we hope that you can actually learn in 3 months. Because if you don't, then Code Academy is a great story. Like, oh, it was great how they were able to, like, start. And then they all failed. And, like, we would have been done, which would have been great. But we were able to be successful, and that's when we knew we could
do
more.
What did you learn from the first class about how to make it better as you went along?
Oh, everything. Everything. We only had curriculum for the first week.
Yeah.
So Jeff that's all we had. We had the first week's curriculum. We're going to teach this first week. And after we teach the first week, we'll figure out what we're going to teach the second week.
Yeah.
And we basically learned how the students learned during the first week, and then we sat down and said, all right, this is what we're going to do. We had like an idea of what we wanted to teach for the quarter, but we didn't figure it out until over time because Jeff is brilliant. Jeff Cohen is probably one of the best teachers on the planet, bar none. Like not even just in web development, just as a teacher, he's one of the best communicators. And he just fell into our laps because he lived near Evanston in Skokie up in by Northwestern. We just got so lucky to find this man in Chicago. So, So becoming the Starter League, that was your question. I apologize for trumping it.
No, it's great.
But, so yes, we were Code Academy, as a lot of you know, and I think a lot of you probably make the same mistake that everyone else we talk to does, and you call another company by that name, which is a mistake, because what you are thinking of is CodeCademy.com, CodeCademy.com, not Code Academy. So we launched like 4 months before they did, but 2 weeks into launching our website, Y Combinator releases their batch of startups. Out of them, one is called Codecademy. But they have the domain codeacademy.com. So when you type in codeacademy.com,
you go to
codeacademy.com. Yeah. But when you we were a nonprofit, remember? So we were codeacademy.org. Yeah. So we had to build our business off of codeacademy.org while competing with a confusing name with a site that had millions of users at this point called CodeCademy.com. It sucked.
Yeah.
It was really hard. That was probably one of the most challenging and gut-wrenching things we had to go through for the first, you know, 6 to 9 months in operating, because we had to deal with that question every day, and I go to sleep every night not sure as to our future, because I don't know whether our brand is going to shine through because of this name conflict. But we were doing so much good for people, and they were too. We wanted to support each other, but there was just kind of this gridlock. So I met with the founder multiple times, and we ended up trying to come to some sort of resolution with the name conflict. But more than that, Mike and I realized we had a larger opportunity. We realized that we weren't teaching just code. It got to the point where, you know, Mike and I started this because, not because we wanted to become programmers and get jobs and make money. We started this because we believed that software was one of the best ways to solve meaningful problems with technology for people that we cared about. That's why we started it. So we wanted to teach people design. We wanted to teach people development, and we wanted to teach them how to actually think through what problem do I want to solve with design and development, and how do I do it, and how do I execute on that. That's why we did it. So we realized that we aren't just academy for coders. We're, like, at this point, we're starting. We're starting companies, we're starting careers, we're starting products, and we're allowing people to join into a community, a league of people that could support each other for the rest of their lives. So that was the idea of the Starter League. We were like, you know what? We are so much more than a code academy. We are so much more than that, and let's show people that we are.
It's what business are you really in?
Yeah, it's what business are you really in? And we put a stake in the ground and said, this is the business we're in. We're in the business of starting companies, products, and careers, not just getting a job and learning how to code.
Yeah, that's great.
So it was so much more for us. And then in tandem with that was our awesome announcement with 37 Signals.
Yeah. So talk a little bit about that, because that was an exciting announcement and a big thing for you.
Yeah, so, I mean, 37 Signals, for those of you who don't know, they're, I guess, one of the most prominent software companies. They have software called Basecamp that's very, very popular for project management. But on top of that, they also created this technology called Rails, Ruby on Rails, to be specific, but it was Rails that they created, the language Ruby that they leveraged. The Rails framework and the Ruby language are some of the most prominently used technologies in software. And that's what I taught myself for that year. So I knew these guys. I knew they were in Chicago. They were my favorite company in the world. There was 37 Signals and Apple. These were the two companies I admired the most.
Well, and they've got a great story themselves.
Yes, they do.
You know, Signals versus Noise, their blog is a great blog, very popular. Jason's written these
Jason
books.
Fried wrote that book that I told me not to quit my job, that I quit my job, like, reading. And I base a lot of
and
how...
And don't they have an investment from Jeff Bezos?
So Amazon, Jeff Bezos is the only investor in 37 Signals, and that was a while ago. So, so they have an interesting story, and I don't know, I really looked up to them, and I just kept in touch. I met Jason at a Ruby class that I took before we started the school. I met Jason there once, and I just kept in touch through email, and I just got to know him periodically through email from time to time. I would write emails that are like 2 or 3 paragraphs long because I'm so excited. And he would respond with like one sentence, like, cool, that sounds good.
And that
good
would
luck.
Make you think for like an hour or two of like how
reflect,
to respond.
Yeah. So anyway, I went through all that. But then something happened where we were getting a lot of success and a lot of traction. And I think it was around the time we had our first demo day in this room.
Yeah.
Where we shoved a certain number of people in here. And it was really awesome. But anyway, after he heard about that and our success with the Moxie Awards and things, he reached out and said, hey, let's get lunch. So I got lunch with Jason, and it was just cool because I felt like I was sitting across from a celebrity. Like, in my head, I'm like, oh my God, it's Jason Fried. But when I was talking, I realized he's just a human being who's, you know, has his quirks, and he's really smart, but he's weird too, and all that kind of stuff. So I told him how the business was going, who I was, what I was about, and we started having more conversations. Yeah. So we got lunch again, and then we got lunch again.
Then we got breakfast.
And then Mike reached out, and then he said, hey, you know, I want to meet Mike. And we started talking. He's like, you know, I've been thinking, like, I'm really impressed with what you guys are doing. I'm trying to figure out how can 37 Signals help you all, like, do this? Like, is there any way that we can, you know, support you guys? And, you know, he's like, I've got some ideas, but, you know, I'm curious to know what you think. And I'm sitting there like, you're helping me right now. Like, you're talking to me.
I mean, just like a year before, like, we were reading, like, Rework, like, on my couch. And then, like, a year later, I'm, like, across from Jason, like, eating, like, you know, chicken and waffles or whatever.
Yeah.
Like, this is the weirdest thing ever. But it was kind of funny, though, because what was amazing about that, the first time I met him with Neal, is that, you know, he was saying, like, oh, you guys were really successful, and we really admired that. But, like, your story and how you, you know, were built and what you're about and, like, the philosophy and the values that you have, it's, like, almost wrong for us not to help you. And that's when I heard that, when we heard that from Jason, it's like, okay, that's awesome. But, like, it felt so surreal to hear that from, you know, someone that we've looked up to for so long to say, like, you know, it's almost, like, you know, wrong for us not to help you guys out. And we want to help you in a more substantial way in the long term and not just, like, a, you know, kind of flash in the pan way. So that was amazing.
Yeah, and it was great. It couldn't have been better because that company, 37 Signals, they really value education.
Yeah.
Like, teaching is a very important concept to them. So what we were doing really resonated because they've always been passionate about it. The only problem is that they're a software business and a company, and they're building products all the time. So they can't really invest as much time in the teaching side, even though they have a built-in classroom in their, you know, in their space. So we filled the void. We filled the void for them. They want to see us succeed. They want to help us do all the things that I just talked about, empowering people to start careers, products, and companies, and ship great software. So they're going to help us do that. Yeah, so they invested in us, but that's not even the biggest part because it was more of a formality.
Oh, but it's a big statement.
Well, yeah, it is a big statement because 37 Signals has never invested in any company before. Yeah. So that was a big deal. It was a really big deal and a big statement to the software community and to the Chicago community, two Chicago companies coming together this way. Mm-hmm. But really, it was a formality. I say that because it was just a small amount so Jason could justify all the time he was spending with us, helping us out. Yeah. And he was like, I'm spending so much time. This, I need to make sure that, you know, I can justify this to the team and get everybody on board. So I remember he didn't tell anyone that it was going to happen except for David Hinmeyer Hansen's partner in the creative Ruby on Rails. And I spoke at their all-team meeting. So 37 Signals is primarily a remote company, but they fly in their entire team, 36 people, to the Chicago office once or twice a year. And I came to speak, to tell them my story. And then Jason told them at that event that, hey, by the way, we're investing in the Starter League. So welcome to the family. So it was great because now we've been a part of one of the best companies in the world, in my opinion, and we're learning every day from them how to be better business leaders as well as better software creators.
That's great. That's great. What a great story. Yeah. A great testament to your success. So I want to work a question in here along with, so talk about a little bit about the vision for how you'd scale this.
Yeah.
What is your vision to scale what you're doing?
I love the scale question. Yeah. I love the scale
question. We've gotten that from day one.
Yeah, we've been getting that from the very beginning. How are you going to scale it? Are you going to go outside of Chicago? How do you teach more people? That kind of thing.
Yeah.
And we always just, like, smashed it. Like, that whole idea of scaling wasn't even that interesting to us because that's not why we got into it. Remember our story. We're not looking at, oh, yeah, how can we make the most amount of money and get the most number of butts and seats and, you know, generate the most amount of revenue. That was never a driver for us. The driver for us was how can we create the best experience possible for people that align with the values that we have that want to solve meaningful problems. That was always a priority. So when it comes to scale, it happened in a sense because we grew. We have two classrooms now. We teach five or six classes instead of just one or two. But that was because people were knocking down our doors telling us that they wanted to learn. And basically, we've just been trying to ensure the quality of the experience for those people, not kind of selling ourselves short in terms of quality by trying to expand in a way that kind of negates the culture and the environment that we like to create and foster. It's almost like saying, like, would you scale Harvard? Like, yeah, they have online classes and it's open or whatever, but there's something about going to that school or to Northwestern or somewhere that means so much more and that is so much more valuable. And we knew the impact that we could have on people if we had them in this environment around us, that would be the best, most, like, quality experience possible. So that was ultimately our focus. We are, I guess you could say, scaling, but not quite in the way that one would think.
Yeah, I mean, our big value is, you know, quality over quantity.
Yeah.
And one of the meetings when we met with Jason and David, over lunch, and we had this conversation kind of about our vision of what we wanted to be, when we were transitioning from Code Academy to the Starter League, was that, you know, we're more than just code, like Neal was saying earlier, more than just design, but, you know, kind of what we did in creating a school, we created a successful company, and we believe that other people, no matter what their background and no matter what their experience, had that same ability. And, you know, in that conversation, we were, you know, talking about it's much more, we'd rather be, you know, helpful in helping like 100 people become starters and become people who, no matter what happened, like if all the jobs were gone, they would be, you know what, I have an idea and I want to solve it, instead of having 5 million users on a site who are kind of learning.
There's this really unfortunate funnel now in learning. In learning, there's online learning, there's blended learning, and there's in-person immersive learning. And the funnel is our instructors are very, very passionate and vigorous about refining this, because what happens on an online course when it's just online, you're behind a laptop like I was for a year, is the funnel is, let's say you have 100 people sign up for a course, about one or two people end up getting the full value out of that course and actually move forward with those skills. In a blended model, which is like using online resources in an in-person environment that's facilitated by facilitators or whatever, you get a better hit rate. You get 20 or 30 people out of that 100 that end up getting through.
The hesitation universities have on it is when they've tried it.
Yeah.
They find, like, you watch the lecture, come for the discussion.
Right.
They find a lot of kids don't watch the lecture.
No, but here's the thing. I don't want to say that it's not valuable, because there are people, some amazing people out there.
Some of these things work better in theory.
In theory. Yeah, but the thing is there's, what about the other 99% of people is basically what I'm trying to say.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because there's the retention and the immersion model is far greater. Out of those 100 people, usually 90. Out of, like, with us, it's more like 99.
Yeah.
And the kind of impact you can have on those people in a short period of time is far greater by leveraging you still get all those fun resources.
Yeah.
But then at the same time, you get this much more high quality education. So when we talked about that, like, I don't know, clearly you can tell I'm really excited about this whole scale question, because I just kind of attack it, because we're scaling in the sense that we're gonna be training CPS teachers to teach what we do in Chicago Public Schools, possibly impact thousands of students in the next year. Yes, we're teaching for University of Chicago for their graduate computer science class. The Starter League is teaching advanced web development to UChicago's graduate computer science students. Yes, we're doing that. Yes, we're teaching at Northwestern for Kellogg. We're teaching their MBA, an MBA class for web development. We're teaching that class, which has a waiting list outside the, like, out of the door. 30 students in the class, 90 students on the waiting list.
You guys are really awesome. I have two Northwestern student body presidents here, which we're very proud. I took a trip for Northwestern, and we went to Harvard and Stanford to do some benchmarking on innovation for students. And another time I have to pull you guys into this conversation, get your thoughts as entrepreneurs and alums. But we went to Harvard, and Harvard isn't known for its engineering. So it has good engineering, but it's not that big. 50% of all Harvard undergraduates, by the time they graduate, take CS50, which is the intro CS class, and they have a version for poets, and they all get the T-shirt, CS50 T-shirt.
Mm-hmm.
It's really cool. It's the thing to do. People love it. At Stanford, where 30%, 32% are engineers, 90% of all Stanford graduates, graduate undergrad, take intro CS. The central CS. By the way, both these classes are geared the way you guys think about it, which is you got to ship something at the end. This isn't theory. It's how do you apply it and how do you understand how to do it. 90%, 50% of Stanford English majors take intro CS. So, you really see this trend happening with young people. You see it happening at elite universities. And the best example I heard was people said, it's for this generation, you have to think of it like learning a language. Like, same reason why I learned Spanish when I was in college, right?
Right.
Learning a language is how do you converse in the broader world that you're going to be a part of.
Yeah.
And so you guys are very much on the cutting edge.
Yeah, I mean, we both are really passionate about this one. So the same way of learning a language, as you mentioned, we use the same example, for what we do. I took Spanish for 5 years, and my favorite Spanish word is no, because I just did it in the classroom, and I didn't really, apply it. But you talk to, I talked to my friends who went to Spain for even 6 weeks, and they come back almost as fluent, Spanish speaker. So for us, the whole, the intro to CS and all these classes, they're great for just an online program. But in order to really be serious and immersed in it, that's what we want more. And that it's great to see this whole learn to code movement.
Right. So you can learn a language in school, but here's the thing. I would be careful to say that CS50 or those intro classes, that's what this is not. This experience is very different. And the reason I'll say that is you can learn Spanish in class just we did or whatever. But what Emily Ellison, one of our students in our class, who's now a web developer in New York, but she was a TA for a while as well, she said on one of our videos, coming to the Starter League was and learning Ruby on Rails here was going to France to learn French. So yeah, as good as Rosetta Stone is, or learning how to, you know, speak a language in class, there is nothing that beats studying abroad and immersing yourself in the language around everyone that speaks it.
Oh, no question.
And that's exactly what kind of experience we've created here at the Starter League.
No, I believe it. You know, it goes to the point, though, of people, if you knew 90% of Stanford students took it, you would have believed you had a market going into it. If you look at 50% of Harvard students take
right.
it,
yeah.
you know that the demand for what you guys are doing is real, because it isn't just
yeah.
engineers taking this.
No, well, it's not even those people, though, because believe it or not, we have people that are studying computer science school
yeah.
and that study computer science that end up still coming to the Starter League.
I mean, computer the whole
science,
class.
Computers, the people have dropped out of their like school, U of I and U Chicago and different places that have computer science backgrounds that say what you're teaching here is more valuable than what I am learning there. So I don't want to say that we replace computer science, because we do not,
yeah.
but we do give you practical skills to ship web apps,
yeah.
which is what most people want.
Yeah, it's great. So a few more questions here before we wrap up. The amazing culture of the Starter League, how do you cultivate it?
I mean, the biggest thing that what we focused on when we started, you know, what was then Code Academy, is that we wanted to build the best physical environment. You know, there's the standard pieces of an instructor, you get a space, you get some computers, but our focus was, you know, to build it organically. There are a lot of people who wanted us to, you know, oh, we need to get jobs, like these students need to get jobs. And then there's the other side of, oh, everyone needs to become an entrepreneur. But our focus was, let's get beginners, people like us who didn't have the opportunity to go through a computer science program or didn't have the opportunity to, you know, learn to code when they were 6, 7, and 8, to create an environment, a non-intimidating environment for them to say, like, you can do it and we believe in you.
Mm-hmm.
And then to find those people who are really passionate about solving a meaningful problem and who are willing to work hard, and giving those, putting the right people in an organic environment is what started, you know.
That culture seeped through our pores.
Yeah.
It seeped through our pores, and we didn't cultivate it as much as the
no.
students did.
Yeah.
They created the environment that they have now.
Yeah.
Like, and we were just a part of it. We were just
yeah.
lucky to be a part of it. So like all the different like quirks and funny moments and hackathons and meetups and funny moments in class and Jeff Cohen's crackly voice and just like all these hilarious things that happen make it fun and enjoyable. But at the end of the day, the culture we had was all the time, 24/7, learning, building, shipping, collaborating, and having fun. That's it. And it just happened.
It was a byproduct of
what we already believed and what we were about
yeah.
and the people that we brought on. And they ultimately helped that culture come to life.
One last question from the crowd here. I haven't seen you around 1871 much this quarter.
Me.
For Starter
League.
It's
not on me.
What have you been working on?
Yeah, that's a great question. So this was the first quarter that I've actually kind of like stepped back a little bit from running like the main operations of the school and being really hands-on. Mike and Vince have, you know, kind of taken the conch on that in a big way. And the reason being is I wanted to spend a lot of time with Jason over at 37 Signals and really take and learn from him so that I could come back to the Starter League with a lot more knowledge, information, and a product. So I'm actually building something right now. I'm taking what I learned, because I ended up actually taking my own class last quarter. I actually took the Ruby on Rails class last quarter. Even though I was a TA before, I could only TA the first 6 weeks. But I took the class and I'm applying what I learned there, and I'm becoming a developer and designer, and I'm building a product for the students. I'm working on something that will help make their experience better. I'm doing finally what I always wanted to do, which is like build and ship software, and I'm having a blast. It's so much fun, and I'm so excited, because all I think about day in and day out is how I can work to make sure I'm providing something for our students and for these people that made my life so much better, because every day I get to work for the Starter League. So that's what I'm doing. I apologize for not being around as much. But if you want to see me, if you're a student, next Thursday between 4 p.m. and 6 p.m., come hang out with me, because I will grill you on your pitches for demo night or starter night next Friday. So, yeah, if you want to talk to me, though, any of you in here, if you want to reach out to us, we're totally accessible, and we'd love to talk to each and every one of
yeah.
you if you reach out. So.
Right. Well, thanks so much, guys. You guys are terrific. What a great
Thank
story.
You.
Thanks for sharing.